Well, good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. It's so nice to see so many people on this webinar, and happy Veterans Day to you as well. So this is a special webinar. We're celebrating not only Veterans Day, but the 2020 National Cybersecurity Awareness Week, which is led by NICE and NIST. And we at CSU's Cleveland Marshall College of Law's Master of Legal Studies program in Cybersecurity and Data Privacy are excited to talk to you about the state of cybersecurity jobs. And so before we dive in, I'd like to start with some introductions. So I'm gonna move to the next slide here. Well, I'm Julie DiBiasio. So who you hear talking is the Director of Graduate Studies and Professional Development here at Cleveland Marshall College of Law for the Master of Legal Studies program. I'm happy to and willing and hopeful to speak to you about our Masters of Legal Studies program more in depth. So please at any time, feel free to reach out to me. My contact information will be at the end of this presentation. But what I know you're all here for is to hear from Professor Brian Ray and Spence Witten. Before I introduce Professor Brian Ray, who will introduce Spence, I want to mention that I know both of them would like this to be a discussion. So at any point, if you would like to ask a question, please go ahead and chat any of your questions in the question and answer section or the chat box. I will be monitoring both of those and we will answer them in real time. So Professor Brian Ray, he teaches in the Master of Legal Studies in Cybersecurity and Data Privacy and our JD program at Cleveland Marshall College of Law. He also co-founded and directs the Center for Cybersecurity and Privacy Protection at Cleveland Marshall College of Law. Brian, I'm gonna toss it over to you to give a little bit more about your background, and then if you will introduce Spence.
Thanks, Julie, and welcome everyone. And I wanna echo Happy Veterans Day. Thanks for taking the time to join us on this, what might be a holiday for many of you. As Julie mentioned, I am a professor here at Cleveland Marshall College of Law. I co-founded and direct the Interdisciplinary Center on Cybersecurity and Privacy Protection, which is based at the law school at Cleveland State University, but incorporates faculty and students from across campus in a variety of programs. And I also co-founded and teach within our Master of Legal Studies online Cybersecurity and Data Privacy program. And very excited to have Spence Witten with me here today. Spence and I are going to talk about, his career a little bit in cybersecurity, because he, like me, came to cyber from a non-technical background, but unlike me, he's actually mastered the technical side to a significant depth. And then we're going to use that experience, both of our experiences, to talk to you about the exciting world of cybersecurity jobs, and in particular, cybersecurity jobs that that are related to law and regulations, which is really every cybersecurity job, as you'll see. But in particular, a number of roles really require you to have a fairly in-depth understanding of the legal side, even if you're not a practicing lawyer. And there are plenty of jobs out there for practicing lawyers as well. So let me start by introducing Spence. Spence has been a longtime friend of our program. He created the Cybersecurity One course for the online program. And he has a really interesting background. As I said before, he just did not have a technical degree, but he got involved in a number of business roles and ultimately ended up in the cybersecurity field, working for what was then Lunarline, and Lunarline has now been purchased and merged into Motorola. But Lunarline is a cybersecurity company that provides both services and education and training at a very high level, including to a number of defense and national security agencies. And in that role, Spence has been involved in both working with clients to structure programs, to deliver services, deliver education, as well as in designing Lunarline's own online education program and training programs. And so really pleased to have him here and part of the program. And I'll let him sort of flesh out the bare bones that I just gave and tell us a little bit about himself and his background. So go ahead, Spence.
Thank you, Brian. I appreciate the introduction, and happy Veterans Day to everyone. And thank you for for taking time out of your holiday on this important occasion to join us for this wonderful conversation about cybersecurity career paths and understanding how law fits into that and how the NICE framework fits into that and how to think about your futures as cybersecurity professionals. And so, like Brian mentioned, you know, I came to cyber sort of randomly. I graduated college in 2005, and like, you know, a lot of folks, it was really hard to get started. And I sort of randomly ended up working for a venture capital consulting company. And so in 2008, you know, when the economic world fell apart, venture capital got hit pretty hard, and I was, out of a job, which was fine because, you know, I didn't really want to sit around and stay in venture capital, but I also didn't really see myself going into cybersecurity. It was an emerging issue. We knew it was important. I knew a little bit about it from the venture capital side, but it wasn't something like I was super excited about. It wasn't something I was really, you know, trying to direct myself to. And long story short, I wound up at a federal contractor working on cybersecurity stuff. And I fell in love with it. And not just because it was sort of the one sector of the, you know, global economy that wasn't a complete disaster, right? Federal cybersecurity was doing pretty well even in 2008. But just because it was a lot of fun. And one of the cool things about cybersecurity, that's also a challenge about cybersecurity careers, is that cybersecurity is a multidisciplinary challenge. And so folks from all different walks of life, technical, non-technical, really into computers, not into computers at all, can come together and make a difference in cybersecurity. And so this is really cool because it's sort of a flexible free-for-all and how you can direct and how you build skills, but also is a challenge both for individuals trying to chart a career path and for organizations trying to organize their cybersecurity skill sets and understand where the gaps are and how they build an organization that's ready to face modern cyber challenges. And so this is where the National Initiative for Cybersecurity Education, NICE, comes into play. And we're going to be diving into NICE in a little bit more detail later on in the presentation. But one of the things I kind of want to show you is how the cybersecurity community is coalescing around a really disciplined way of thinking about cybersecurity skill sets. And how you can position yourselves to grow as professionals along this path that we're all starting to understand and coalesce around, and how our program fits into that and how we help students prepare themselves for futures as cybersecurity pros. And back to you, Brian.
Yeah, thanks, Spence. And that's a really important point that we'll touch on throughout the conversation today. And as Julie mentioned, if you have specific questions, just feel free to pop them in the chat and we'll address them. Spence and I can talk forever, even though we talk a lot to each other, because this is just such an interesting topic. But real quick, before we get into the NICE framework, which we'll spend some time in, just here we've got a representative sample and really should have the more recent CCPA on here, or now CPRA, which are the California laws. California came online with the first statewide comprehensive data privacy law and then decided it wasn't good enough. So the voters just voted to change it in the last election. So it's going to get even more complicated. But the larger point is the number of laws related to both data security and data privacy, although increasingly data privacy is the dominant realm, are growing and continue to grow. GDPR is kind of an umbrella framework for all of the European laws that are out there, and all the European laws sort of tie back to that. But there's a range of other things going on in Europe. Just a news item yesterday that Europe placed restrictions on the sale of surveillance technologies, which is another interesting area that I've got some expertise in. One of the things that you begin to know, whether you come to cyber from a business perspective, realizing it's a risk to the business that you've got to manage, or that your product depends on meeting certain compliance standards, which is increasingly the case. Or if you're on the technical side and you're deep in the weeds of trying to construct the tools or use the tools and construct the program, or if you're on a compliance or legal side where you're squarely in this, law kind of frames quite, law and regulations frame quite a bit of what you're doing, because the many of the risks, there's always outright business risks, but many of the risks that you're trying to manage around and decide how to prioritize your resources, because you're never going to have a perfect cybersecurity system. So you got to figure out how to prioritize them. And much of that prioritization is just simply driven by what are the legal risks? How sensitive is that data? Is it subject to certain specific compliance standards? Frankly, what are the penalties if I end up having a breach with respect to that data? And or if you're in an environment like health, you know, what are the potential regulatory fines that might accrue if there's an investigation that shows I wasn't doing these things that I'm supposed to be doing? And so that's really the raison d'etre behind our program. We started out teaching these legal frameworks to law students and decided, you know what, they can't really do their job properly as lawyers if they don't understand the technical side. And then had increasing interest from non-lawyers wanting to get the legal background. And so as we'll talk about today, almost any job, you need to understand at least some dimension of this, and especially as you proceed through the ranks and get more senior and have a strategic position, it's just really important to have the ability, not that you're gonna know all of the regulations in detail on their own, but once you have that general framework, then you're able to adapt and consume and understand what it is that new regulations require. So let's jump in then to the NICE framework. And as Spence mentioned, NICE is a national standards setting organization that flows from NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, cybersecurity frameworks, which are sort of the gold standard frameworks that almost all of those laws and regulations and other frameworks map back to. And what NICE's mandate to develop was, well, given the practical guidance that's coming out of NIST as to how to structure and grow and mature a cybersecurity program, what are the roles, what are the jobs, and more importantly, what are the practical skills that you need to have a workforce, or that you need in your workforce to be able to accomplish the objectives that the NIST frameworks provide. And so we're gonna dive into, we're gonna sort of go in, not wholesale, but actually we'll put a link in the chat so you'll be able to go to the full NICE framework and see what we're pulling from. But we're gonna start to jump into some of these frameworks right now, or parts of the framework right now. And so starting here, and I'm going to, Spence, now turn it back to you. This is the most, so the way the NICE framework works is on the left side. Oops, we lost it. Julie, I think you're cut. Let's wait on it. There we go. Well, we'll throw that in the chat later. Don't worry about it now. So the way the NICE framework's laid out is you've got category, specialty area, work role, and work role definition, which is, you know, nice. In some ways, it's a little bit too elaborate, but it's a really nice, detailed breakdown of here are the kinds of things that you need to have, the skill sets you would need to have to do these roles, and the kinds of roles that you want in your workforce, right? And so the category legal advice and advocacy, that's an obvious one where it's legal focused, right? Not just lawyers, but compliance as well, which is that second box on specialty area. And you know, these are the people that are really going to be doing the legal analysis. And again, importantly, within most organizations, it's not just the lawyers that are doing this. There are a set of professionals at the top. It's often the chief privacy officer, if they have one. And the chief privacy officer sometimes is a lawyer, but doesn't have to be a lawyer. And then the folks below that person within the organization are deeply involved, usually not, although sometimes they'll be dedicated to privacy, but often doing compliance with respect to a range of regulations. And so that's, you know, that's one obvious area and a real growth area where we're seeing lots and lots of new openings, new demand, again, because of that explosion of laws that are just continuing to grow. And then of course, the second box, training, education, awareness, if you're gonna do training, sometimes you'll be training more on the technical side, but even there, the technical side needs to map to these laws, because the controls you're putting in place are controls that are often either specifically dictated or used to meet the compliance requirements. So let's flip to the next slide, and then I'm gonna hand it over to Spence. So Spence, you wanna talk a little bit about risk management generally and how that that specialty area really connects these different dimensions of cyber?
Yeah, absolutely. And also, I want to step up to just a quick higher level for folks that may not have been able to dive into the NICE framework or might not be familiar with the NICE framework. So like Brian said, the NICE framework, the work roles and the special areas that we're looking at right here, is an awesome organizational tool for thinking about cybersecurity skill sets and careers. If there's one knock against the NICE framework, it is that it is extremely complicated. And it's a little dense, and it takes a while of looking at it to really understand how all the pieces come together. But I still encourage you to take that time. I mean, I think if you know, spend an hour with the NICE framework, reading through it, it'll eventually start to make sense. And why it's so important is that, like I had mentioned before, because cybersecurity is such a multidisciplinary challenge, and because so many people kind of like myself are self-taught, it's sort of been a free-for-all Wild West on the career side. And so the NICE framework is an effort to bring some direction and discipline to this, so that on the individual side, you can look at potential career paths and skill sets and areas you can focus on and build capabilities in. And then if you're managing, you can think about what skill sets your organization needs to function in a modern cyber world. So it is complicated. It is a little dense, but I do encourage everyone to take some time and read through it, because it is a wonderful way to break down some of the mystique that comes from a free-for-all Wild West discipline and bring some focus to it, and so that we can start understanding on an individual level how we fit into the world. And so with the risk management perspective, so risk management is really interesting.
Spence, can I just elaborate on that a bit? And the other nice thing about it is, once you start to learn the language and understand it, first of all, it gives you a framework for trying to understand the world that you're either thinking about advancing and or entering. But also, as you describe yourself in your resume, right, you want to kind of map to these languages and identify the skill sets that you've got. It gives you a nice common language, as it were, to communicate to employers, hey, here's what I can do. And just simply knowing it really, you know, demonstrates that you know your stuff and that you're interested and engaged in the field.
Perfect. Thank you, Brian. And so when we're looking at the risk management area here with the two work roles that we have up on the screen, so we have authorizing official and designating representative. This is very federal terminology, federal DOD terminology, but you know, it's widely applicable to other organizations too. Most organizations have the buck stops here type of responsibility for system security, where there is ultimately someone that needs to say that this aspect of our IT environment is secure and I take ownership over that. And that's what the authorizing official or designating representative does. That's their role in the organization, is to plant a flag and say, hey, I've looked at this component of our IT infrastructure, you know, this system, this thing, this process, and I have declared that it is, you know, to the best of my ability, that it's as secure as we can make it, usually based on some standard for evaluation. And so this is a skill set that we really, in our program here at Cleveland State, you know, we really prepare folks to assume that we prepare people for lots of different paths, but this is a very clear kind of career objective path that our program prepares folks for, because it is, again, at the core of that multidisciplinary aspect. So as an authorizing official, you may not have to be a lawyer, but you really have to understand all the key regulatory requirements that impact your system and the day-to-day operations of the people who use that system. And you cannot escape that. And that's not even just federal, right? That's outside of federal. If you're working in finance, you're working in healthcare, or even if you're working for a small mom and pop shop somewhere, it's the same deal. You have to understand the regulatory environment you operate in. And then on the flip side, you also have to, even if you're not necessarily like, you know, genius level technical, looking at code, like, you know, coming up with new exploits, you know, the really fringe super technical areas of cybersecurity, you have to have a technical familiarity enough to understand your IT operations, understand how to do basic assessments of those IT operations, and what to do about those findings. You got to bring those two together to be able to make the kind of informed decisions about risk and say, you know, the risk of operating this system is low enough that my organization can do so without, you know, risking, you know, serious impact from cyber attack activity. And then the other career path that's under there, security control assessor. And so this is usually a third party, though some organizations have them internally, where, you know, someone's looking at the flip side of that, right? They're evaluating a system both for compliance with various regulations. So that could be federal regulations like, you know, those promulgated by NIST, or they could be, you know, private sector regulatory requirements like PCI. It doesn't really matter. You know, they're looking from an external perspective, usually, again, as an independent third party, usually, to say whether or not that system is in compliance with those requirements and is of, you know, has implemented controls in a way that really genuinely improves system security posture. And so it's the same challenge, right? You have to understand the regulatory requirements and the legal requirements. You don't have to be a lawyer. In fact, most aren't, but you do have to have a deep grounding in regulatory compliance. And you have to understand enough on the technical side to conduct those kind of technical reviews to assess whether or not a system's actually secure. And so this, I think it, we keep hammering away on this point, but it's a key element of how we approach, you know, educating future cyber professionals is bringing together that legal and regulatory side with enough technical expertise that A, you know, you can understand what you're seeing from a technical perspective when you go out and you run scans and you look at vulnerabilities and you look at network architecture diagrams, and B, you have enough of a framework that you can build those technical skills in the future because the technical world constantly changes. And so we help. And, you know, most of our students coming in have absolutely no technical background, and we give them that framework and that initial basic confidence that, you know, they can go out in the field, understand what they're seeing, and then build those skills throughout their career.
Yeah, and just to elaborate a bit, I mean, one of the key sort of soft but critical skill sets that very few programs teach you is how to speak each other's language. And so we get folks from all different backgrounds within the program, and our faculty, as Spence and I are illustrating, is drawn from both the legal and the technical side, and we put you together and make you sort of work on those different dimensions, which is absolutely critical. So one course that I teach with JD students is we get the JD students together with MSIS students on the technical side, and we do NIST-based security assessments, which is essentially what a security control assessor would do for nonprofits. And it's really always amazing to me to watch the law students who only have gotten the basic technical grounding from Cyber Security One, which is the same course we teach in the online program, and the MSIS students, which often have no legal background at all, but sort of, you know, really have strong technical chops. And to watch how they, you know, sort of explain to each other and learn from each other how to apply the NIST framework, which is a general framework, but requires you to try to figure these things out. And you know, that just underscores how important it is to get an understanding of sort of both worlds, as well as the business and strategic side. Because in the real world, to do your job well, you can't just stay in your silo and say, well, legal will manage that or technical will manage that, because otherwise you don't have an effective program.
Brian, if I may, because I think that's a great point to emphasize too. So, and it's just for whomever is on the, you know, all the audience here, you know, let's say you come from a, you know, super technical background. The world, as Brian mentioned, you know, as the laws both increase in complexity as well as quantity domestically and internationally, even if like you're a, you know, a great penetration tester and that's your focus, like you can't ignore the regulatory environment anymore. You have to have a grounding in that to be successful as a professional. And so, you know, sometimes with our pen testing teams, we're dragging them kicking and screaming into learning that stuff because they really want to stay, you know, fingers on keyboards. But, you know, you can't ignore that stuff. And on the flip side, you can't just be a lawyer or a regulatory compliance expert or a business expert and not have a degree of technical familiarity. Again, you don't need to be a technical genius. You don't need to be, you know, dreaming up new exploits in your spare time, but you got to be familiar with this stuff because we're having that convergence. The regulatory compliance side is getting ever more technical, and the technical side is getting ever more focused on regulatory compliance. And it's coming together and it impacts every role across an organization.
Julie, let's go on to the next slide then. And here again, moving across, actually, Julie, I think we skipped one. Oh no, you're in the, wait. We didn't get to cybersecurity management. There we go. All right. So in many respects, this oversee and govern, outside of the sort of legal roles, are the kind of roles that we're trying to prepare people to have the full suite of core skills that they can then build on throughout their career to reach this level. And again, because when you're at the oversee and govern level, you're at the sort of strategic pinnacle or just below it, where you're taking responsibility for the program and often, core aspects of the organization that you're working in. And you really have to be able to talk to everybody, right? And you have to be able to understand what the experts below you who are sitting in one substantive area or another are telling you, and then make judgments about, whether you need to probe for more, whether you can trust what they're telling you, and then report up, or if you're at the very top, make the call, right? And so, these roles, you definitely have to have a really strong grasp of the regulatory environment you're working in, because that's, again, dictates much of the risk. And I'll turn over to Spence to talk a little bit more about some of these roles.
And again, so this is a another area that it's very federalized language, but it is generalizable to the rest of the organizations, particularly complicated organizations. So, information system security manager. So we talk about authorizing official as an ultimate person who has to sign off on a system security posture. With an information system security manager, you're oftentimes in that authorizing official role, but not necessarily. It's a very day-to-day operational operations focus. And so, for those of you in the audience that are familiar with cybersecurity, that a lot of the day-to-day stuff really isn't that super exciting. It's operational stuff. It's, executing a patch management process. It's running a, configuration management process. Somebody wants to make this change to the system. How do we figure out whether or not that's a secure change? It's, making sure that vulnerability scanning is happening on schedule. It's coordinating the penetration testing teams. And again, it is another, it tends to be a little bit more in the weeds operationally than, some of the other roles we've talked about. But at the same time, it's bringing together those diverse skill sets. So, in an ISSM role, you have to have, those basic people skills that kind of come with the, traditional business type background. You got to understand the technical aspects. You got to realize the regulatory compliance environment. And one of the cool parts about the ISSM job, you have to be able to see in the future for where the organization's evolving so that you can help that system or that component or whatever you're responsible for grow in a way that supports overall system objectives. So maybe let's say you're an ISSM for a call center supporting the Internal Revenue Service, and that you need to grow to, this call center is going to grow to support another 50,000 daily calls. And all this stuff is going to happen to make that possible. And so it's not necessarily your responsibility to build that IT infrastructure, but you have to be able to see around corners and look down the road to understand what the security impacts are going to be, so you can advise all the different stakeholders in that process how to meet those objectives, but do so securely. It's a really neat role to play. It's a role that's increasing in importance as we get more involved with, building cool systems and moving stuff to the cloud. And as some of the more really neat modern IT tools make their way into big organizations, it's a fun role. But again, another one of those multidisciplinary roles. So ComSec manager is very, very specific to Fed. So I think we can gloss over that. I mean, it's a very specific role for very specific types of organizations. But cyber workforce developer and manager, I think it is exactly what it says it is. And so if you're in that role, you're understanding things like the NICE framework. You're understanding the future skill sets that are required. You're, understanding what is going to be required from a skill set side, 1 year, 2 year, 5 years down the road, and you're helping your organization build those. So, find the right people, maybe develop internal training or go buy external training to help people develop their skill set, and understanding how skills and people are evolving to face these threats. And it's a really exciting role because the field is changing so much, and because training is becoming so much more disciplined thanks to organizations like NIST and the NICE initiative, helping us develop frameworks for building people and building human resources. But it's another job that, you know, where you have to bring together those technical and regulatory compliance sides. And we focus on helping. In fact, we have some students in our program now who are, explicitly focused on doing this because they come from an education background. And again, like I said, when I, at the very beginning, you can come to cyber from any type of background. We have, superintendents of schools, we have principals, we've had teachers who are learning the skill set, the cyber skill set side and the technical side, so they can play this role, because it's increasingly important for organizations. Moving down to cyber policy and strategy. So this can be high level, like a lot of people think when we use the word policy. So advising lawmakers and governments on high level policy, but it also goes deep into an organization. So policy and security can have a very granular message. And so it used to be that you could play this role without some technical familiarity. And the world has just gotten so complicated that you really do need to have that technical background, not background, but technical comfort level to play a meaningful role in policy. And I don't say that to scare people off, because I'm confident no matter what background you come from, we can give you the base technical knowledge you need to play a role in policy, and it becomes a personal differentiator. And so another message that I hope everybody in the audience comes away from is that, you don't have to be intimidated by the technical side. It really, anybody can learn the basics enough to make a meaningful difference. And doing so will be a major differentiator for you on an individual basis. So, if you're coming in from a policy perspective, and policy and law is something you really, really love, and you want to play a role in that process, but you also can speak the technical language, you can talk to the super technical folks, you can, you've done some hands-on technical work yourselves, whether it's just in our program or even for other organizations, you bring so much to the policy process. And you're all of a sudden, you've gone from, someone who can just help out with policy to someone who's instrumental and critical to that process, because you understand both sides. You get policy and regulation, and you understand the technical landscape too. And you're just invaluable to whomever it is that you happen to be supporting. And then obviously executive cyber leadership, this is stuff like chief information security officer or chief information officer, or even, CEO. Some organizations are so impacted by cybersecurity environment that, even the CEO can't escape it. You can't delegate it. It's just too important. We help prepare folks at that level, because you still need that grounding in the regulatory compliance side, along with that technical grounding too.
Okay. And so we'll move relatively quickly through the next two slides. So just to again illustrate the sort of breadth of areas where this mixed skill set's important. Investigations, you're going to be working intensively with legal requirements. If you're doing crime investigation, obviously you need to understand how to speak the language of the lawyers and the law enforcement folks. And then forensics analyst. You're the one going in trying to figure out, well, what happened, and sort of, go through and unravel the chain from the incident backwards, as well as the defense forensic analyst. And these are really critical roles that'll work directly with law firms or in-house counsel, because ultimately, what you're worried about once you've had a breach is either regulatory investigation and or litigation. And so you need to document for yourself, both to do remediation, but also to manage the downside risk, figure out what regulatory obligations might have been triggered. Is it a reportable breach? Do I need to report to relevant regulatory body? And so the technical side is going through trying to figure out, well, what actually happened? But on top of that, okay, and does it qualify to meet the standard that these laws have laid out for certain either legal obligations or potential legal risks to manifest? And then ultimately, if there is anticipated regulatory investigation, you got to work with the lawyers. And in particular, really big area here that many technical firms in particular don't pay sufficient attention to is the potential role that attorney-client privilege and work product play, because a really interesting developing case law that I've done a lot of work on around what are the best practices to allow access to the raw information that either, that in particular plaintiff side would need to figure out and make their own case while still allowing for candid and protected conversations on the legal risks that are manifesting. And really the best practices are that you do a two-track analysis. So one team is doing a sort of just the facts. Here's the technical reality that we're uncovering. And another team is doing that while talking to the lawyers about whether certain legal obligations have been incurred. And so those groups really work hand in glove. The lawyers who are incident response need to be able to talk to the technical people in real time, and the technical people need to be able to talk to the lawyers in real time and make really important critical calls that can be incredibly costly if you go the wrong way under intense pressure. And so, you can't just wait and sort of hope that you can figure it out. You got to be able to talk to each other. Spence, I don't know if you want to add anything here.
No, you nailed it.
All right, perfect. Let's go to the next one. And then here we've just got some of the more deep technical roles that aren't necessarily sitting at a real strategic level. But even these, as you look at examples of them, understanding the legal environment so that your analysis can feed up to those people in their strategic roles and really be more value to them. If you yourself can offer up independently, hey, we might want to think about X with respect to the legal side. And Spence, I'll turn it to you here because you've got a deeper understanding of these roles than I do.
Yeah, and so this is another great example of how lots of different folks can play a role in cybersecurity. And so, again, the audience here is extremely diverse. You all come from various different backgrounds. And I hope throughout this presentation, you're starting to see, where you fit and also understand that, yes, you do fit. So if you're from a cyber background, you already obviously see that you fit. But, if you don't have that skill set, I want you to know that, there is a home for you in this discipline. There's lots of different ways for you to play. And so that's really well reflected on this screen. So warnings analyst, again, we're very DOD focused term, but it's still what it, it's understanding, what the indicators are you're seeing and being able to prepare your organization to face those. And so it is not an overly technical role. It has technical elements, but a lot of it is, reading intelligence reports, a lot of which, you'd think only comes from, say, the National Security Agency, but there's a whole ton of really, really great private sector intel reports. And if you work in a large organization, it's likely that you're company or organization subscribes to a lot of those. And so you'd be sifting through that and trying to figure out, what's real, what's not, and what to do about it. And again, not super, super technical. It's something that, lots of different folks from lots of different backgrounds can play a role in. Exploitation analyst tends to be extremely technical and oftentimes has an explicitly offensive focus. So this is something done mainly by the government, and it is very technical. I mean, you're piecing together, you're understanding adversarial networks, you're understanding the vulnerabilities on those networks, and you're putting together packages of exploits to go after them. So it's a very offensive role, very DOD and intelligence community. But then down into all source analysts, you spend most of your day reading news. So if you're a news junkie, this is a great role for you. You're going to spend a lot of time looking at some overt news, open source news, and some maybe poking around on the dark web to see what criminal organizations are up, which ones are down, who's doing what, when, where, why, and how, and understanding all that and briefing information security teams on your findings so they can do something about it. Again, not a very technical position. I mean, most of our, my company does do cyber intelligence work, and most of our cyber intel folks, they have to get familiar with tools and they got to learn how to run them. But they're bringing a very, sort of liberal arts mindset to the challenge of sifting through all that data. It's a lot of fun, and it's a great way for individuals that don't necessarily have a technical background to break into a cybersecurity field by becoming that type of all source intel analyst. And then mission assessment specialist, again, very, very DOD and language and even Fed civil language. But again, it is really about understanding and developing either strategies, plans, executable approaches for achieving specific objectives. A very broad work role, but again, highlighting that fact that lots of different skill sets are needed to tackle the cyber challenge.
All right, thanks, Vince. And Julie, you know, let's skip that next slide, which just, you know, goes into some more detail, but just in the interest of time, let's go on then to the program details, and then we'll feel free to post questions in the chat and we'll address them then, but we'll leave a little bit of time for question here at the end. And so Julie, you want to give them a quick overview of our program?
Absolutely. Well, first I want to thank both you, Brian and Spence, for that really informative presentation. So if Brian and Spence at all, which they did to me, motivate you to start this program or to look more into this program, both of them are professors in this program. So as you can see, they're both very knowledgeable and passionate about this. So just think about what your classes would look like. So just briefly, our program, our Master of Legal Studies in Cybersecurity and Data Privacy, is part-time or can be full-time. It's very flexible and it's fully online. We enroll in every single term, so the fall, the spring, and the summer. Our next upcoming term starts January 11th, and we are still accepting applications for that cohort. It's a total of 30 credits, which are 10 courses, and you take them consecutively. So every single semester, you will take some courses. And again, we can be flexible with that. And I encourage you to reach out to me if you're want to learn more about how we can tailor this program to fit your schedule. We are able to do that. We have some students who take one course. We have some who take two or three courses, even four a semester. And so again, I encourage you to reach out to me and we can talk about what your individual curriculum will look like. So here is the curriculum. Here's a snapshot of the 10 courses that we offer. Spence teaches in Cybersecurity 1. Brian teaches an Introduction to American Law. So I want to toss it back to Brian. We won't go through every single course in detail, but I'd like both of them just to speak a little bit about the two courses that they teach. So Brian, I'll toss it back to you quickly to talk about your courses.
Sure, and just to emphasize here, Introduction to American Law, Legal Writing, Cybersecurity 1 and Cybersecurity 2, along with Privacy Law and Management that you'll see in semester 4, really these are the core that give you that thorough grounding in both the legal and the technical sides of things. And so the first two semesters will really get you that nice foundation. And then we move you through some upper level, more law compliance focused courses to deepen that in semester 3. And then Privacy Law and Management is really from an operational perspective, integrating the compliance along many different dimensions from the perspective of a multinational. Introduction to American Law, we completely recreated this course for this program. So that it's cybersecurity and data privacy focused, gives you the grounding in being able to read cases, read regulatory materials, understand the core components of focus on the American legal system, but also looking a little bit internationally, a version of what you get in your first year of law school, but compressed into a semester and focused on sort of getting the core skill set so we can quickly advance you through it. And then Cybersecurity 1, I'll let Spence talk a little bit about that. And then we'll move on to the next slide.
And actually, I would like to take a brief pause to answer a question.
Oh, yeah,
that
sure.
Has come in from Christy Markwell. So her question is, if you are an attorney looking to get into cybersecurity, but have no technical knowledge and can't commit to an LLM program right now, what would be a good cert to gain a deeper technical understanding? That is a wonderful question. So cybersecurity remains a very certification heavy field. And so that is changing as degree programs come online. So 5 years ago, there were no cybersecurity degrees, or very few at least. And now, trailblazers like Cleveland State have developed, great programs. And so there is, but even with those degrees, it's still a very certification heavy state, or discipline rather. And so to answer Christy's question, a good beginner cert that actually does qualify you for some federal jobs that require certifications is a cert called Security Plus. Security Plus is not an overtly technical cert, though it does test basic knowledge on particularly on networking focused security issues, which is really important to understand how networks focus. And Security Plus is a cert that anybody, you could be an English major, you could, maybe dropped out of high school. It doesn't matter. Like, I'm confident that anybody can sit down with a Security Plus study guide and maybe some online courses, which are really inexpensive, and knock out Security Plus. There's lots of stuff you have to learn. So, I mean, even some technical folks struggle with it just because it's stuff that, they've forgotten, basic facts and figures about, networking in particular. But this is a cert that anybody can tackle. Cert on the technical.
And Christy, reach out to us, because the other thing that we offer as a sort of lighter version of the full MLS is a certificate that incorporates Cybersecurity 1, Cybersecurity 2, Privacy Law and Management, and some others. We'd be happy to talk to you about that and work with you on seeing if a smaller version of this in a certificate makes sense for you. Because the nice thing about Cybersecurity 1 and Cybersecurity 2 is that they're designed to give that technical background to people with no technical experience as well, so that we do get folks with technical experience who are looking either for a refresher or to, to get that angle with a legal perspective. So sorry, Spence, I didn't mean to interrupt, but I wanted to just mention that.
Yeah, that's wonderful. No, thank you, Brian. And so the other good one that I'd recommend if you're feeling especially ambitious is Certified Ethical Hacker. So we have, a great example was a technical writer in my company. We put him through he really just wanted to dive into the more technical side, and we put him through a 1 week boot camp for CEH and passed with flying colors. So I think that CEH is a little harder if you haven't been hands-on, like if you haven't run Nmap to, enumerate a network, or you haven't run and looked at a vulnerability scanner. I mean, there's a lot of tools that they kind of expect you to at least be familiar with, but that doesn't have to stand in your way. And a lot of those tools are open source where you can play with them on their own. So if you're feeling especially ambitious, CEH is worth going towards. Just, I would say it would probably take you about a year of relaxed study and playing with tools to get to the point where you felt comfortable taking that, whereas Security Plus would be a matter of weeks with the boot camp. So Security Plus is a good one to start with. CEH, Certified Ethical Hacker, if you're feeling especially ambitious, are two good, beginner to intermediate technical certs that would build your skill set in that area.
Yeah, and one of the things that we're working on is most of our courses already map to some of these external certifications. The International Association of Privacy Professionals has certifications that are more on the compliance privacy side, and Privacy Law and Management is built around that. But the Certified Ethical Hacker certification, Spence and I have been talking about, he's eager to create a course that would essentially provide you the background for that. And it's really a question of whether we can directly connect it with the group that provides the certification. That's something that we're hoping to fold into this program in the near future.
And another thing that I'd like to emphasize for everybody is that, even absent, if you don't want to bite off a full cert right now, most of the tools, you got to be very careful. There are real strict legal requirements about, what you can and cannot do with cybersecurity tools. But there's a distribution of Linux called Kali Linux. It's free. I'm confident that anybody that, can poke around on YouTube and instructional, other instructional videos on Google could figure out how to download, install, and get working. And it has a full set of cybersecurity tools that you can start playing with. Again, I really don't advise you to you know, point a scanner at the FBI and see what happens, because that's not going to go well for anybody. So you have to be very careful in how you use these tools, but you really can start playing on your own. And I want the industry to move away from being self-taught, because folks that are self-taught end up with lots of gaps in their knowledge, but it is still a great way to start. There's no financial commitment. You can play on your own time. I mean, if you only got a couple of hours a week, or, you know, you can to poke at stuff, you can learn the basics. And so I do encourage people to do that too. I mean, the tools and the resources are out there to start learning how tools work. And that's at least how I learn. And that's the philosophy I bring to the program, right? So to bring it back to answering the question for Cybersecurity One, you know, particularly for adult education, I mean, this is a program focused on folks that have a little bit of professional experience. I don't learn now. I mean, ever since I got an undergrad, like, I have to be hands-on to learn. I mean, I have to, like, you know, get my hands on, try something, not have it work, then finally have it work, and then go back and kind of understand the principles. And so that's how I approach Cybersecurity One. It is a lab-based course. I don't know of any intro to cybersecurity courses that are designed for people with absolutely no cybersecurity knowledge that are lab-based. I have you download Kali Linux. I have permission from, you know, CSU to run basic scans against CSU assets. So you can get hands-on there. You will get extremely, extremely frustrated because I'll have a hard time getting it to work. And I'm going to hold your hand until we figure it out together. And you're going to get going in the right direction. And you're going to get hands-on with these tools. And then on top of that, we layer on top of that, that theoretical education. So, you know, there's the textbook, there's readings, there are exercises like you'd have it in a traditional class, but the vast majority of your grade, you know, over 50% is based on the labs. And that the whole purpose of that is to get folks that aren't technical, like, you know, Christy, and from her question, get you hands-on with cybersecurity tools so that you're no longer intimidated by the technical aspect and you understand how to go build your skills on your own when you leave that class. And so it's really fun. I think all my students hate me for the first month as they're starting to get up to speed. Because it is a lot for folks that have never done this before. It's kind of intimidating. There's a lot going on, but you know, you get a whole ton of attention from me as we learn these labs and we get through them together. I mean, I will hold your hand and we'll do them together if we have to, because yeah, I just want you to get through it and build that comfort level. And then by, you know, the second month of the program, students are having a blast learning how to replicate websites and steal credentials, learning how to scan networks for vulnerabilities, understanding what those scan results look like, learning how to break into encrypted documents. I mean, we're having a lot of fun and learning in the same breath. And so that's the philosophy for Cybersecurity One. And then you can take that technical grounding into semester two, where Brian takes back over.
Yeah. And so then in Cybersecurity Two, you basically go back through those same topics, but in the context of working as with your colleagues and teams to develop a HIPAA compliant. HIPAA is the healthcare regulation, which is one of the most extensive within the U.S. In semester three, you go into deep dive into it. But in Cybersecurity 2, you develop the technical security plan, set of security controls. So it's really an application that builds directly on it. And then in legal writing, you're going deeper into learning to consume, use, and to some extent produce legal materials. Happy to answer any questions about the other courses in the program. Note that some of the ones in semester four and semester five, these are examples of many of the courses that we offer. We're bringing them online sort of one course at a time. And so in the initial iteration, they might be different, but eventually we're hopeful to have a range of potential options in semester four and five, and actually to some extent in semester three as well.
We actually do have ahead. A question. We have a question from Preston. It's a question near and dear to my heart. So Preston is in high school and wants to know what you know, he can do to get you know, to build his skill sets before he graduates. And he has downloaded Kali Linux and has been playing around with it. And Preston, please continue. No, so it is a good idea.
Care.
The issue is the issue is be very, very careful. I mean, treat it like a loaded weapon. So there are, and it also depends on what state you're in. So the patchwork of laws governing how and what you can do with cybersecurity tools are really complicated. I mean, lawyers truthfully don't even really understand them because they're a wild west, right? I mean, it's one of those areas where 10 different lawyers have 10 different opinions about what is and what is not allowed. And if you get in front of the wrong judge, things can go really badly. So you just gotta be really careful about what you're scanning. And I would encourage you, so if you have the technical chops to download Kali Linux and run it in a VM, I mean, that's not necessarily easy stuff, then you could probably get online and learn how to build your own lab environment on your computer. And so you could build a home lab environment for free. I mean, you can download their various applications like BWAP, so buggy web application. You can run on a virtual server on your computer that you can bang on all you want. You can hack into that all day long. There are other examples out there. And so the safest way to experiment is to do that. So I would go and learn how to build your own little cyber lab and start practicing. And then, look for internship or even work opportunities. You know, just because you're in high school doesn't mean, you know, you can't start looking for employment opportunities to build that skill set. I would also point you in the direction of certifications, but one of the challenges there is they require, what's that?
Sorry, we got one more question and we're running a little long time. So let me invite Preston, feel free to reach out to us and we can give you a little more information over email. Spence obviously is he's got a lot of great information to share on this, and he does a great job working with our students to make sure we're staying within the bounds of the law. And by the way, it's thanks to him that Ohio's revised criminal code allows for this kind of activity, because we almost went down a path that might have made it potentially illegal. But Robert Thomas is asking, if you've got your JD, do you have to repeat Intro to American Law and Legal Research in writing? The short answer is not necessarily, and we're happy to work with you. We have a number of lawyers in the program. Interestingly, the ones that so far have gone through have wanted to do those to get the background, but we're always happy to work with you. And if you've got the JD, absolutely, we can certainly easily waive legal writing and Intro to American Law, likely. But let's have a conversation about it, and we'll talk to you. And then what you would do is later in the program, as I mentioned, we're bringing new courses online each semester. You'd select from an additional set of related topics if you want to do the MLS, because our accreditor requires us to have 30 credits to issue the degree. Excellent. So any other questions? Then I'll turn it back to Julie to close us out.
Great. Thank you, Brian. And thank you, Spence, again. And Robert, I'll answer your question quickly. It says, how long is the program? And so it's a total of 30 credits. It's 10 courses. If you do this on a part-time basis, which is 2 courses per semester, it'll take about 5 semesters. However, we are very flexible. Some students take 3 to 4 courses per semester. Some take 1. So it really depends on what you're able to take on. So you and I can speak privately to talk about what your individual curriculum might look like. But quickly,
Julian, just to, okay. The other thing is, Robert, reach out to us, because as I mentioned, response to the other question, we also have a certificate version, which is fewer credits, that, you know, if you're not interested in the MLS, but you want to get the core courses, again, contact us and we'll give you more information about that.
Great. So what I just want to highlight here quickly is that our next cohort is starting on January 11th, the spring cohort. We are still accepting applications. The deadline is December 14th. To apply to this program, you will apply online. Everything is listed here on this slide for what you need to apply online, but I strongly encourage you to reach out to me so we can talk about your background, make sure that this program is a good fit for you, and I, of course, can step you through the application process. Here is my contact information. I also chatted Brian Ray and Spence's contact information in the chat. They really would love for you to reach out to them. As you can see, they love to talk about this topic and are passionate about it. So if there aren't any other questions, and it's almost 1 p.m., I want to say thank you, everyone, for attending. I know I speak on behalf of Brian and Spence when I say we really appreciate your time, especially on Veterans Day, and encourage you to reach out to us with any questions about the program or cybersecurity careers in general. Brian and Spence, is there anything else you'd like to add?
No, just thanks for joining us, and definitely reach out if you've got more questions that we can answer offline. And thank you, Spence.
My pleasure. Thanks, everyone. Happy Veterans Day.
Thank you, and have a great day, and we hope to hear from all of you soon. Bye-bye.